Hi, my name is Dr. Mohammad Kobir Hossain. I am an assistant professor of civil engineering at Dhaka University of Engineering and Technology, DUET Gajipur, Bangladesh. Today I'm going to talk about structural repair of structural crack repair by epoxy injection. As you can see, the topic is here. Structural crack repair by epoxy injection, and this is the a specific procedure recommended by ACI committee, American Concrete Institute committee E706. This document is freely available on ACI website for free download, so you can just browse the ACI website and download it for your use. I downloaded it from that website, and I'm just showing you what I got from them. So this is part of a series of lectures on field guide to concrete repair application procedures. So this is the first lecture, I'll say, and they named this series as ACI RAP bulletin, and this is the bulletin number one, where we are going to discuss about a structural crack repair by epoxy injection. So as I said, it's a series of lectures, and this is the first lecture, and we will use only epoxy for crack repair. Let's go into the discussion, and we'll just start with introduction. So why do cracks occur in concrete? As there are certain things that is inevitable in life, such as deaths, taxes, concrete cracking is inevitable too. Where there is concrete, there is cracks, we can say in this way. And there are lots of discussions, theories, why concrete cracks, and how these cracks form, how this can be repaired. That's our discussion part here. So we'll just see one of many methods today to repair structural concrete. And here are some of the reasons why concrete cracks, such as drying shrinkage, thermal contraction or expansion, settlement, uneven settlement. If uneven settlement occurs, then you should expect cracks in concrete. And as you know, concrete can contract and expand. And if the contraction or expansion is restrained, then you should expect cracking in concrete. And as you know, when concrete hardens and sets, it releases the surface water, and due to the fast rate of surface water release, it tries to contract the top surfaces, and since concrete is weak in tension, it just develops cracks because it cannot take the tension stresses. There are some more reasons why concrete cracks. Here are some of them. Lack of appropriate control joints. If we do not provide control joints, you should expect cracking in concrete. Overload conditions that produce flexural, tensile or shear cracks in concrete. So if your structure or member is over stressed, then you must expect cracking in concrete. So your stress may be flexural or direct tensile or shear cracks or shear that may cause crackings in concrete. And also, if you just restrain the movement of concrete members, for example, if the concrete wants to expand under thermal load, then if you if it wants to contract, I will say, then that's easier to understand. If it wants to contract due to thermal changes, for example, the temperature goes from 20 degrees Celsius to zero in an hour, then the concrete wants to contract. But if it is restrained, then tensile stress develops, and that causes tensile crack. So restraint of movement may cause cracking too. What are the solution to repair the cracks in concrete? We are just going to discuss one of the many ways here. One of the potential effective repair procedures is to inject epoxy under pressure into the cracks. So that's what the title says too. We are just going to discuss only one repairing method, which is epoxy injection. So we just inject epoxy material into the crack, and we are going to discuss how we are going to prepare our surface, then how, what's the application procedure, and how we can ensure the quality too. So all those are coming step by step in the following sections. So we inject the epoxy into the cracks under pressure, as you can see, under pressure. So you must apply the epoxy into the cracks with certain pressure. Otherwise, good quality will not be achieved. The injection procedure will vary subject to the application and location of the cracks, with horizontal, vertical, and overhead cracks requiring somewhat different approaches. So injection procedure will vary depending on your location of cracks. If it's a vertical crack, so you should start from the bottom and go up and inject the resin at some certain locations, which we called port. We will come to that in a moment. And you can just repair the horizontal cracks and also the cracking in the ceiling, I'll say. You can just repair those cracks using this this technique, which is epoxy injection. And remember, this one is just to restore the structural capacity. That means the after repairing, the structure should resist the forces or stresses that it is supposed to carry. So it's not just to fill the void, it must restore the capacity of the structure. So that's why we are calling it structural crack repair. Okay. The approach used must also consider accessibility to the cracked surface and the size of the crack. So depending on the location of your cracking, the application procedure might have changes. Cracks can be injected from one or both sides of the concrete member. For example, if it's a structural wall and both side, you can see the crack from both side, then you can inject epoxy from both side. If access is limited to only one side, installation procedures may include variations in epoxy viscosities, injection equipment, injection pressure, and port spacing to ensure full penetration of epoxy into the concrete. So if once you can access the crack only from one side, but the crack depth is higher, for example, more than 12 inch, then you must apply the epoxy with a higher pressure to reach to the bottom or the deepest level of the crack. And also you should have lower viscosity epoxy to reach that, because if the fluid is highly viscous, then it will not flow easily into the crack. So, and also, as we said, we must apply the epoxy at some certain locations, for example, 18th, along the 18th center to center spacing along the crack. So port spacing should be smaller. That means you need to apply the epoxy at closer locations. So these are the things, and also pressure to apply different injection pressure, you must have different equipments too. That's what it's just talking about. Depending on the specific requirements of the job, crack repair may by epoxy injection can restore structural integrity and reduce moisture penetration through concrete cracks 0.002 millimeter inch, that means 0.05 millimeter in width and greater. So depending on the specific requirements of the job, crack repairing can restore the structural integrity, as I said just a few moments ago. This method is used when someone needs to restore the structural capacity. And also, in addition to that, it can repair the moisture flow by closing the gaps between cracks. And if the crack is more than 0.002 inch wider, that means 0.05 millimeter or wider, then it can stop the moisture penetration too. However, before any concrete repair is carried out, the cause of the damage must be assessed and corrected and the objective of the repair understood. So this is important too. Before we apply any repairing method, we must know what is causing the cracking. For example, if the crack is subject to subsequent movement, an epoxy repair may not be applicable. So if it moves back and forth due to thermal expansion and contraction, then this epoxy injection will not help you in restoring the structural capacity of the member. So you must provide expansion and contraction joints, say, or you must remove the restraint that's restraining the movement. And also for example, if we know that corrosion of steel is causing the crack, then this will not help you in restoring its concrete capacity. It will restore the capacity for a certain moment, for a fewer duration, I will say, for less duration. But in the long term, the corrosion will occur again, and epoxy injection will not help you in restoring the integrity of the structural member. So you must know what is exactly causing the cracking, and you need to remove or repair or restore that before you use the restoring or repairing mechanism. So note is given here, horizontal cracks of sufficient width can be filled by gravity fed epoxies where suitable for the repair. You can see here, horizontal cracks of sufficient width can be filled with gravity fed epoxies where suitable for repair. So you can just use the second one. We'll discuss this topic in second lecture. So the lecture following this one, we will just discuss this method to repair the horizontal cracks with gravity fed epoxy. So, but remember, this one is just the epoxy injection method, and the next one will be gravity fed epoxy method. Now, what is the purpose of this repair? Why we want to repair this crack? I think we have discussed this one, but let's read it here again. The primary objective for this type of repair is to restore the structural integrity and resistance to moisture penetration of the concrete element. So we want to restore the structural integrity. That means it should carry the shear force bending moment that it is supposed to carry. And also it should not permit the flow of moisture through it. So that's why we want to repair the crack. Now, when do I use this method? What are the conditions that may suggest you to use a epoxy injection repairing method? Let's talk about it. Injection is typically used on horizontal, vertical, or overhead cracks where conventional repair methods cannot penetrate and deliver the specific repair product into the crack. As you can see, we will discuss in the second class that the gravity fed epoxies that cannot be applied to vertical cracks or overhead cracks, where you need to inject the epoxy from a downward side. But as the name indicates, in the gravity fed epoxies, the epoxy resin flows due to gravity. Due to gravity, the epoxy resin flows into the crack and it just fills the crack. So this is different from epoxy injection. You can inject the epoxy from a bottom to upward direction too. Prior to proceeding with the crack repair by epoxy injection, the cause of the crack and the need for a structural repair must be determined. Why we want to repair the crack? You must, as an engineer, you must determine it first. If the crack does not compromise the structural integrity of the structure, injection with polyurethane grouts or other non-structural materials may be a more suitable choice to fill the crack. So if you do not need to restore the structural integrity, then, for example, you just need to stop the moisture penetration, then you don't need epoxy injection because it will cost you more money and it requires a lot of work, I will say. So in that case, you just use a simple polyurethane grout and inject it into the crack, which is non-structural. That means it will not carry any forces and it will not restore the structural capacity. And it is easier, cheaper. That means the economic solution. So depending on the causes and depending on your purpose, you should select appropriate repairing technology. When a structural repair is required, conditions that cause the crack must be corrected prior to proceeding with epoxy injection. As I said, if the thermal contraction and expansion is causing the cracking, you need to correct that first before you apply the repairing, this repairing method. And this repairing method, we are calling it epoxy injection. If the crack is damp and cannot be dried out, an epoxy tolerant to moisture should be considered. So if you are just repairing a crack under the gravity, under the water table, so for example, underground water table, then you must expect water during crack repair. So you need to use a water tolerant epoxy here. So depending on the location of your crack and the condition of your crack, you need to select the method of application. You need to select the right epoxy. We'll discuss in a moment what type of epoxy should we use, etc., etc. Cracks caused by corroding reinforcing steel should not be repaired by epoxy injection because continuing corrosion will cause new cracks to appear. So if the cracking is due to the corrosion of reinforcement, you must correct the, you must take a specific measure to stop corrosion of steel. Otherwise, epoxy injection will help you for a moment, but in the long term, it will not stop the cracking. Cracking will form again. So now, how do I prepare the surface? You can see a crack here. Cracks must be clean and free of debris. So how do you start the working actually? Before we apply the before we inject the epoxy, we must prepare the surface first. And as you can see, these cracks must be free from any debris and it must be clean. So the first step is to prepare the surface. Then we'll select what type of material should we use. So let's talk about surface preparation. Clean the surface area about 1.5 inch, 13 millimeter wide on each side of the crack. That means on both side, 13 millimeter, 13 millimeter, it should be a 1 inch wide strip on along the crack. So 1 inch strip along the crack, you should clean it with wire brush. So because if you use other method, for example, grinding, you can use grinding tool to clean it, but grinding will fill the cracks with debris and dust. So wire brushing, grinding with wire brush is recommended here. This is done to ensure why we need a clean surface. Because we want to ensure that materials used to seal the top of the crack, which is called the cap seal, will bond properly to the concrete. So we will see that before we inject the epoxy, we must cover or seal the top of the crack. So we use a top seal. We can see, we can call it cap seal. We apply a cap seal on the top of the cracking surface first. So just to make a mold, you can say. We have, if we just see it as a V crack, then you have two surface and then we cover the top surface. So it forms a rectangular void, a triangular void. And then through the port, we just inject epoxy resin. So before we apply the epoxy resin, we must seal the cap or the top surface of the crack. So that's why to have a proper bond between the cap seal and the concrete surface, you must clean it. Wire brushing is recommended because mechanical grinders may fill the cracks with unwanted dust. Contaminants can also be removed by high pressure water, oil free compressed air, or power vacuums. So you must clean the, after wire brushing, you should blow high pressure water or oil free compressed air, or you can use power vacuum to clean all the dust and unwanted particles. When using water to clean out the crack, blow out the crack with oil-free compressed air or heated air to accelerate drying. So if you use air, high pressure water to clean it, then you must dry the surface before you apply the cap seal. So to do that, to accelerate the drying procedure, you can use compressed air or heated air. Yeah, and that must be oil-free to accelerate the drying. Otherwise, allow enough time for natural drying to occur before injecting moisture-sensitive epoxies. And you can allow enough time to dry it naturally, then you can do that too. Where concrete surfaces adjacent to the crack are deteriorated, V-group crack until sound concrete is V-group the crack until sound concrete is reached. That means if the crack is heavily damaged, then you need to cut a V-group. You need to cut a V-group and you need to go as deep until the good quality concrete is found, obtained. So you can just cut a V-group and the depth of the V-group should be up to the good concrete, actually, I can say. V-groups can also be used when high injection pressures require a stronger cap seal. So we can just cut a caps V-group along the crack and then apply the cap seal, and then we need to apply the epoxy through the port. So once we prepare the surface, then before that, actually, we need to select the epoxy material. There are several grades of epoxy material, and here SCI committee E706 recommended the ASTM C881 grade epoxies here, where you can see there are two types of epoxies. One is for structural application. You can see type one for using non-load bearing application. Sorry, I just said the inverse thing. Well, type one is for non-load bearing application and type four is for load bearing application. So for a structural application, we will use the type four one, and the epoxy quality in terms of viscosity, consistency, bond strength, heated deflection temperature, linear coefficient of shrinkage, compressive strength, those are listed here. These are the minimum and maximum values, for example, either something grade one low viscosity, that's the maximum value, and grade two minimum is medium viscosity, that's the minimum value. And maximum for this one should be 10,000. So you can refer to this table for a specific quality, and of course you must check whether the epoxy supplied by a manufacturer complies with this ASTM requirements. So we need to select the epoxy depending on the situation and location of our crack. The appropriate viscosity of the epoxy will depend on the crack size, thickness of the concrete section, and injection access. As I think we have discussed this one earlier. For crack widths 0.01 inch, that means 0.3 millimeter or smaller, use a low viscosity epoxy. For example, a viscosity an epoxy with a viscosity of 500 centipoise or less may be appropriate for cracks with widths 0.01 inch or smaller. For wider cracks or where injection access is limited to one side only, a medium to gel viscosity material may be more suitable. So if the crack is wide, that means the fluid or epoxy can flow easily. So it can have higher viscosity. But if the crack width is narrow, small, then you need a highly fluid epoxy. That means the viscosity should be low. ASTM C881 standard specification for epoxy resin based bonding system for concrete identifies the basic criteria for selecting the grade and class of epoxies. I think we do not need to discuss this a lot, because you should get, as an practicing engineer, you just need to check the supplier information, the information that has been supplied with this material with the ASTM requirement. So if that requirements are fulfilled, you can use it for the application. So for concrete sections greater than 12 inch, the working time may need to be increased and the viscosity decreased as the crack gets smaller. In addition to the criteria used in Table 1 for epoxy selection, the following product characteristics may also have to be considered. So you need to consider the modulus of elasticity, working life, moisture tolerance, color, and compressive, flexural, and tensile strengths of the epoxy too for your application. What are the equipments that I need to apply the epoxy? You need to have air guns to clean it actually, and you need to have hand actuated delivery system. As for example, here you can see this is a pump actually. So you can use this pump to inject epoxy into these ports. You can see these are the ports. We are calling it ports through which you just apply the epoxy. So at a specific spacing, we just insert some ports and through which we just apply the epoxy into the crack. We'll just come to the steps or procedure in a moment. So you need a most probably air gun, then hand actuated delivery system, or you can use spring actuated capsules or balloon actuated capsules. You can just search Google and find what are them. For example, I just searched hand pump for resin and I found these ones. I used it for my research in the large scale structure labs of University of Alabama, where we had hand pump there to apply epoxy resins, and we used those. So I don't see that one here in the list. But anyway, you can found how those looks like and how you can apply those. Their operation manuals are there too. Determine the delivery method that will be best suit the repair requirements by considering the size and complexity of the injection repair and economic limitations of the project. Now, you must also maintain the safety measures in applying the epoxy resins, because epoxy resin is a hazardous material and it must be treated in such way. So there are job site response safety measures that you must follow. For example, here are some of the job safety requirements that one must follow. I'll just go through it. Having material safety data sheets available on site, wearing protective clothing and protective eyewear where required, wearing rubber gloves or barrier creams for hand protection, having eye wash facilities available, wearing respirators where needed, providing ventilation of closed spaces, secured short storage of this hazardous material, having necessary cleaning materials on hand, notifying occupants for pending repair procedure. So these are the safety measures that one must use or comply on the job site to avoid any harmful event or any harm to the human body or to the occupant, I can say. And also you can conduct a pre-construction meeting, which can include the owner, engineer, a contractor, material supplier, you can call all of them to sit together and finalize the execution plan. Now we come to the gist of our discussion today, how we can apply the epoxy resin into the crack to repair it. Number one step is port installation. We can refer to figure 2 here, installation of entry ports. As you can see, these are ports. So it's like a tube-like things. These are called ports. So first, after cleaning the surfaces and removing all the dust particles, and if we use water cleaning, then we allow it for drying. Then we apply the ports here. It's like a tube-like thing, and the bottom of it just reaches the bottom of the crack if possible. Otherwise, it should just go as deep as it can. And you must maintain a a certain distance between them. As we said, if the cracks are narrow and you are using a high viscous epoxy, then they should be, the pores should be closely spaced. That means they should be closely spaced, means their spacing should be smaller. Otherwise, you can use a higher spacing. So let's see how we can install the ports. Install the entry ports only after proper surface preparation. Two types of entry ports are available for injection process: surface mounted or socket mounted. Surface means it should be on the surface, or otherwise that if it's on the surface, then you can see a part of the port is above the surface of the concrete surface. Otherwise, you can just cut a socket here, then the port will, top of the port will not be above the concrete surface. And then you don't need to, if the port is, top of the port is above the concrete surface, after finishing the repairing injection work, you must either remove it by heating or cutting in a manner. If you just use a socket, then you don't need to do that. So it depends how you want to finish the work. Entry ports, also called port adapters, can be any tube-like device that provides for successful transfer of epoxy resin under pressure into the crack. So it's a tube-like thing, entry ports. And the function it does is just transfer the epoxy from the machine to the bottom of the crack, I will say, or that just flow, allow the flow of fluid into the crack. Proprietary injection guns with special gasketed nozzles are also available for use without port adapters. So in some cases, if you use just injection guns with special gasketed nozzles, then you don't need a port adapters. Port spacing is typically 8 inch. One center, I think it's a typo actually, 400 millimeter. No, it's not 40 millimeter, it should be 8 inch means 200 millimeter actually. Otherwise, it should be 1.5 inch if it's 40 millimeter. With increased spacing at wider cracks, I think it's not 1.5 inch, it should be actually 8 inch, that means 200 millimeter. Port spacing may also be a function of the thickness of the concrete element. Surface mounted entry ports are normally adequate for most cracks, but socket mounted ports are used when cracks are blocked, such as when calcified concrete is encountered. Entry ports can also be connected by a manifold system when simultaneous injection of multiple port locations is advantageous. That means we can refer to this figure here. You can see we are just using only one port, we are just injecting epoxy through only one port here. But if we want to inject fluid, inject epoxy into three port at the same time, we just can use a extension here. We call it adapter or manifold. So we can use a manifold if we want to inject epoxy in multiple ports at the same time. In step two, we install the cap seal. So after placing the ports, we install the cap seal. Properly installed, the cap seal contains the epoxy as it is injected under pressure into the crack. So remember, we will inject the epoxy with the pressure. So if the cap seal is not and does not stick to the concrete surface, the epoxy will come out easily. So we want to hold the epoxy under pressure until it sets and binds the two elements on both sides of the cracks. So that's why you need to have proper bonding between the cap seal and the concrete. And that's why you need to have a clean surface. When cracks penetrate completely through a section, a cap seal is performed best when installed on both sides of the cracked element, ensuring containment of epoxy. That means if the section is thoroughly cracked, so in that case, you should apply cap seal on both sides. Capsules have been successfully installed using epoxies, polysters, paraffin wax, and silicone caulk. You can use these capsules made with either epoxies or polyester or paraffin wax or silicone caulk. The selection of the capsule material should consider the following criteria, subject to the type of crack to be repaired. What are them? Non-sag consistency, moisture tolerance, working life, and rigidity. That means the modulus of elasticity. Concrete temperature changes after installation of the cap seal, but prior to injection may cause the cap seal to crack. So before injecting the epoxy, if the capsule cracks, you must repair it. And that may occur due to changes in temperature. So you should be careful about that. If this occurs, the capsule must be repaired prior to resin injection. Prior to proceeding with the installation of capsule, mark the location of the widest portion of the crack and pay close attention to the following. So at the widest location of the cracks, you should pay attention to this following things. Use only materials that have not exceeded their shelf life. Shelf life means shelf life indicates the time between manufacturing and application. Accurate batching of components, small batches to keep material fresh and dissipate heat, port spacing, consistent application of the material over the length of the crack. I think shelf life may means after when we just open the can of the epoxy and when we apply it, the time between these two incidents is called the shelf life. I'm not exact on this one. Let's talk about the third step. In the third step, we just inject the epoxy into the crack. For a successful epoxy injection, start with the proper batching and mixing of the epoxy components in strict accordance with the manufacturer's requirement. So you must follow the manufacturer's requirements and the recommended procedure to apply the epoxy. Prior to starting the actual injection, be sure that the capsule and port adapter adhesive have properly cured so they can sustain the injection pressures. As we said, we will use the epoxy under pressure, and you must check whether the epoxy for the capsule and the ports are properly cured and hardened so that they can hold the epoxy under that pressure. If you are insured about the pressure and the curing of the epoxy for ports and the capsule, then you can start injecting epoxy for the cracking. Start the injection at the widest section of a horizontal crack. Be sure to locate and mark these areas before installing the capsule. Vertical cracks are typically injected from the bottom up. So if it's a vertical crack, you just fill the bottom port first, then you go up the upper ones later on. Continue the injection until refusal. Refusal means the cracking, no more epoxy can flow into the crack. So if you just want to push anymore, it just refuses to do that. So it comes out actually. So you must continue pumping until it comes out and it refuses to accept any more epoxy. If an adjacent port starts bleeding, if you can see the epoxy is coming through another adjacent port, then cap the port being injected. You should cap the port where you are just injecting the epoxy through. You cap it and then you pump. You just set the pump nozzle to the other port and continue injection at the farthest bleeding port. Hairline cracks are sometimes not so well suited to pumping or refusal in those cases. That means if hairline cracks appear on the capsules, try injecting the epoxy at increased pressure. For example, approximately at 200 PSI or 1.3 megapascals for 5 minutes. If hairline cracks appear, then you should pump at higher pressure for almost around five minutes. Closer port spacing can also be considered if you see hairline cracks. So actually, hairline cracks are not appeared on the capsule. It is for if the crack in the original concrete element is hairline crack, that means it's very narrow crack, then pumping refusal will not occur. So in that case, you need to apply with a higher pressure and for a longer duration. That's what it is saying. Please take note on that. When injection into a port is complete, cap it immediately. So after injection is done, you must cap the port immediately right after finishing. Higher pressure can be used for injecting very narrow cracks or increasing the rate of injection. However, the use of higher pressure should be managed with care to prevent a blowout of the capsule or ports. Remember, if you apply a very high pressure, then the capsule and the port may just blow out from its location. That means all your efforts is gone. You need to do it again. So you should be very careful, and you must balance the pressure, application pressure, and the pressure that the capsule and the port can resist. In fourth step four, we remove the ports and cap seal. Upon completion of the injection process, remove the ports and capsule by heat or chipping or grinding. If the appearance is not objectionable to the client, the capsule can be left in the place. If complete removal is required for a subsequent application of a cosmetic coating, prepare the concrete surface by grinding. So it depends on further work and also how the client wants to coat the surface. If further coating needs to be applied, then you need to prepare the surface, and maybe you need to remove the top of the port by cutting or heating or chipping, you may need to remove the capsule, or you can leave it depending on the situation. How do I check the repair? Now, after application, you need to check the quality of your work. Whether this repairing is successfully done or not, you must check it. To do that, this is the quality control part. Quality check part, actually. To ensure that the injection has been successful, quality assurance measures may include the test course or non-destructive evaluation. First one, by including test course, and we will discuss the non-destructive testing in second step two. In step one, in procedure one, you can just cut test core from the repaired elements and then check whether the repairing injection is done properly or not. In test core method, core locations should be chosen to avoid cutting, raising, reinforcing steel, drilling cores in areas of high stress, or creating core holes below the water line. So you need to select some locations from where you can extract concrete cores. And you should not select a location where reinforcing steel is present. So for example, if it's a concrete slab, you should select a location between two reinforcing bars. And if the concrete is at high stress, you should avoid that location too. You should select a location where stress is low. And also you should not select a location where water table is present. That means if you cut a core, then water will flow through the core void. The engineer should determine core locations when this type of conditions exist. Be sure the epoxy has set before extracting a core. Take cores nominally 2 inch in diameter or 50 millimeter in diameter to check that the penetration of the epoxy is adequate. Inspect the core visually to determine the penetration of the epoxy into the crack. So from the depth of the cracking, you can visually see what is the depth of the crack and what is the depth of the epoxy. Then from these two, you can differentiate the amount and then you can find the length of the crack, which is still uncracked. That means which is not restored. Then we can test those scores for compressive strength and split tensile strength, which is the destructive test, and subsequently pass the removed core area after proper surface preparation with an expansive cementitious or epoxy grout compatible with the existing substrate concrete or surrounding environment. So you can just test those concrete and you must refill the core area, core volume with cementitious, expansive cementitious or epoxy grout that is compatible with the substrate concrete. In the non-destructive testing method, we just use these three evaluation method to ensure the quality of work, impact echo, ultrasonic pulse velocity, and spectral analysis of surface waves. So in the ultrasonic pulse velocity, you can just measure the width and depth of the crack is still there. So if you see that there is no more cracking or the crack depth is zero, then you can say we have successfully implemented the repairing mechanism. So that's what I wanted to discuss today. We will discuss the is crack repair through crack repair through gravity fed epoxy resin in the later section.